Hello, everybody. Welcome to this, we think, very interesting and very engaging conversation about the Reading Regional Airport. I'm Dave Myers. I'm the director of the Berks Alliance, and we do these community forums, try to do them once a month on topics that we think are of interest to the community, important to the community. So we thank you for joining with us. We ask you to keep your cameras on, but mute your microphone so we don't have a whole lot of background noise. And we will be starting here in a minute. We do record the event, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in a minute, but we record the event and we make it available to everybody who registers for it. So thank you for joining us. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to John Weidenhammer, who is the chair of the Berks Alliance.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining the call. We really have, I think, a super interesting topic to present to the community today. And Dave, I want to start by thanking you. Dave is the executive director of the Berks Alliance, and he takes full responsibility for organizing these meetings and really does a good job at that. But I also want to thank our presenters today. We have Commissioner Christian Leinbach, who's going to kick off the presentation, and then we have Zachary Tempesco, who was the airport manager at the Reading Airport. And if you've been following sort of the story relative to the Reading Airport, you know that there have been some recent changes with the county acquiring the fixed base operators out there. But the changes in the airport really started much before that, and hopefully everybody can, our presenters can give us some background on that. So as you know, the Berks Alliance is committed to community development, and we really have a focus on improving health, wealth, and education attainment of all the citizens of Berks County. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to Dave with thank you again to get things rolling. So Dave, take it away.
Thank you, John. As I said before, we are recording the event. We will send it a copy of the recording to everybody who registered. And we do find that there are some people who are interested in the topic but aren't able to join us. So we make sure we get them a copy of the video. We will also post it on the Berks Alliance website and share it with our friends at BCTV. We ask that you use the chat function at the bottom of the screen to submit your comments and questions. Once we get done with the formal presentations, we will move to the questions and comments. I'll sort of function as the moderator of that part of the program. Any questions or comments that we don't get to answer during the session, we will share them with our panelists and give them the opportunity to respond to them and share those back with everybody who's here for the program. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to the man who is both the chairman of the Berks County Commissioners and is also the chairman of the Reading Airport Authority, Christian.
Thank you very much, David. John, really appreciate the work of Berks Alliance. I really can't let my opening comments go by without noting that while we're focused on air traffic today and air transportation, we would not be where we are today with passenger rail if it wasn't for the initiative of the Berks Alliance. They initiated the study, in my opinion, that brought this back to life. They paid for it. And so the work of the Alliance is valuable to our community. And I really appreciate David Myers and John Weidenhammer and their leadership. So thank you for hosting this. Very quickly, when I was elected back in 2008, shortly after that, I had someone with knowledge of the airport say to me, there's kind of a joke going around, there's no pilots on the airport authority. It's more important to have a real estate license than a pilot's license. And I thought, that's pretty poor. So my goal was to appoint people that were aviation people. The first person I appointed to a vacancy was Craig Lutz, who had his helicopter pilot license. But beyond that, I really believed that we needed a more aggressive focus on the future of the airport. And that really came in to reality over the course of 2021 into 2022, when eventually the county took, and not in a aggressive way, with the existing airport authority, seven members, we took over direct responsibility. And the way that happened is the seven members in October of 22 resigned, and the county immediately appointed the three commissioners and our chief operations officer to take their place. We reformulated the bylaws so that no longer do the commissioners appoint seven members, but the bylaws state that the members going forward are the three sitting commissioners, the chief operations officer or that person's equal, and the director of community and economic development or that person's equal. So today, Commissioner Santoni, Commissioner Rivera, and myself are the three commissioners. Kevin Barnhart is the chief operations officer, and Pamela Mennett, our director of community economic development, is our the fifth person on that authority. We also went immediately from one meeting a month to two meetings a month. We immediately began a tenant advisory committee, and we made a commitment to aggressively grow the airport. That led to the opportunity to purchase the two existing FBOs and create one single FBO. In our research, we found that a number of airports, even surrounding airports, Lancaster, Lehigh Valley International, and others, have a single FBO, and they're able to be more competitive and better control the service that is provided. We had another blessing that we inherited, and that is the person that's going to be presenting to you today. That's Zachary Tempesco. Zach is a native of Berks County. He grew up in the Fleetwood area. And if you have any questions about that, I can tell you I've showed up in the Fleetwood area numerous times, and people come forward. Hey, do you know Zach? Do you know Zach? Well, Zach graduated from Fleetwood High School. He went to, I believe it's the Florida Technical Institute. He could have gone anywhere after his graduation in Florida, but he came back. He became the deputy director at the airport under Terry Soroka. And when Terry announced his retirement under the prior board, I would say, Zach, without hesitation, elevated Zach into the manager position that he holds today. I can tell you it's been an absolute joy working with Zach and his leadership team. And I know you're going to enjoy his presentation. Hopefully, you'll learn a little bit about the history, understand a little bit more why this is valuable beyond just the return of commercial air traffic. Why is the airport important? And if you have questions, I hope you do, please direct them to Zach. I do apologize. I have to jump off. Governor Shapiro is coming to the Reading Area Community College, and I have a pre-meeting with some people from the Department of Education at noon, so I need to head down there. But again, Dave, John, thank you very much. Zach, thank you for your leadership, and thank your leadership team. And Zach, I guess, David, you want me to turn it over to Zach, right?
Yep.
Take it away.
You're on, Zach. Christian.
Appreciate that. Hi, everybody. My name is, again, Zachary Tempesco, Airport Director for Reading Airport. Like Christian said, I did grow up in Fleetwood, went to Florida Institute of Technology. I actually got my private pilot's license at Kutztown Airport prior to that, which doesn't exist anymore. So a lot of ties here, and grew up flying in and out of this airport. So very happy to be here and growing our community, hopefully all together. So I'm going to share my screen here. You see that okay, David?
Yep, we do see it.
Great. All righty. So Reading Regional Airport Authority is the municipality that oversees, and obviously, as Christian explained, the county is now directly involved as our board members. the airport authority here. You'll see on the right-hand side of the screen, there's a photo of the airport on our, what we call an aeronautical chart. The airport is a medium size. That's kind of what indicates that that blue line is our airspace. And we do have the ability to do commercial service, which we'll talk about it a little bit here in future slides. I like to explain the pictures on here because people tend to have questions. So we have one of our base tenants on the bottom left, and that's one of their jets. We have the main runway, 13 in the middle on the bottom. And then our old city hangar, we call it, which is the first building that was built at Reading Regional Airport in 1938. So some very unique history here, which we'll talk about as well. So our current tagline is RDG Elevate Success. So our whole goal here now is to continue to build, because we feel like the more that we can build the Reading Regional Airport, the better the community can, the community benefits from the airport growing. And then we see that throughout the whole industry, any airport. The one I like to use the most, if anyone's familiar with the Denver airport, that was like closer to the city. They actually built the airport miles away, and the city just sort of migrates towards the airport. And the reason for that is because there's a lot of economic development that can occur around an airport as like a growth center. So again, the better we can do here, I think the better for Berks County in general. So our mission: elevate and promote economic growth, education, and connection as the community gateway to the air, to aviation. So the airport is the gateway. That's how I look at it. And I tell all of my employees that, because it's important for the airport to leave the, a lasting first impression. So when someone flies in, again, the governor comes in. I don't know if Governor Shapiro has ever been to the airport, but I want to make sure that the first time that he or she arrives, the governor or anybody else, that they are at least somewhat impressed, or maybe, say, hey, this is Berks County and it looks nice, right? So our vision, to be the top regional airport in Pennsylvania in economic impact and operations. So that came from a study that we're going to talk about in a second, but it's important to understand what we mean by regional airport. So we are number 12 out of 144 airports in Pennsylvania in economic impact, with $77.98 million in impact per year estimated, and that was from a 2022 study. So the airport is number 12. Most of the airports that are in front of us are all commercial service airports. So they have regular scheduled commercial service, and that would be Philly and Allentown and Harrisburg, Wilkes-Barre, those places. Anyone that has commercial service, I think there's 9 airports in front of us. So again, we have the ability, we really do have the ability to be the top regional airport if you look at it from an airport that doesn't have commercial service, but has a very big impact on its community. So we're going to keep striving for that. The next study will be in about 10 years or so. And again, that's on this slide here. You can see community impact study. It's all available online. We have it on our website, and we also, it's on the state's website if you want more information about the study and how things are gathered. But most of the time what they do is take the airport, all of the businesses, all of the people that work around in and around the airport, and how we touch the community. So one of our big drivers is Quest Diagnostics, which I have a picture in the middle there in the snow. So that is a Quest aircraft being loaded with medical specimens. And then they go all over the country. And it's really important that we have a good relationship with Quest. So the airport never closes. And we're here we're available. The airport's available 24/7 for any plane to land here. Our staff is here 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. And then overnight, it's like we're slightly unattended, but obviously on call should anything happen. And we're anytime it snows, we're here making sure that the runways are open. So just as an example, Quest has told us, this was years ago, actually, that if the airport were to close one day or one night, that it's possible they could lose up to $5 million in revenue for that day. So again, a lot of people depend on those medical specimens getting out and being tested quickly. So it's important for us to make sure that we're here and available for them all the time. And that goes for many other operators here as well. Again, as the traffic moves through the airport, the better the community does. So you can see some of the numbers there. Again, total employment at the airport with all the businesses is about 441 jobs. The total payroll is over 26 million, and the total output for the airport is over $77 million annually. So again, top picture is our terminal, which is that's probably last summer. So again, we're keeping up with it. It's over 20 years old already, and we're going to keep this facility as nice as we can. That bottom picture, I put that there because that's one of our economic drivers. One of our biggest ones in the county is the World War II weekend, which will be coming up June 7th, 8th, and 9th this year. It's always the first full weekend in June. And if you have not been to that show, and I think I have some more pictures later, it is very impressive. And if you've grown up in Berks, maybe you're a little complacent to the show, but I want to make sure everyone's aware that that is the biggest World War II event on the East Coast, if not in the country, as far as number of reenactors and things that take place on the ground. So very cool. Reading Regional Airport Authority, again, top right, we explain what that is and how the county got involved. Big part of that was BBP Solutions. So they did our community evaluation. They did a business plan for us, and they also did a communications plan for us as well, and helped us develop some of the things that we're going to talk about today as far as our goals for the future. And then our bottom right, that's our brand new logo for Reading Aviation, which is our new fixed-based operator. So we're going to talk more about that later, but just some background. A fixed-based operator is the fuel provider on the field, and they provide the primary aviation services. Not necessarily maintenance in our case, but we provide all the ground services. Like when a visiting aircraft comes in, now the authority is in charge of making sure that that aircraft is greeted, that it's serviced, that we can get fuel for that aircraft, greet the customers or the guests, and then they can turn around and leave whenever their departure time is as well. The airport itself, just a quick overview of the facility and the grounds. So you can see Reading Airport in the middle there. We have about 770 acres. We did have more. We sold a tract of land to the east of the airport, which is between the secondary runway that runs north-south and the river. And that's Berks Park 183. So this photo is a little bit older, but if you've driven around the airport lately, you'll see the big FedEx facility that was built on that property. Again, we did sell that off. That was, I think, 190 acres of property at the time. And that was sold to Berks, BCIDA, Berks County Industrial Development Authority. And they facilitated the relationships with developers. And now we do have another facility going up, which the final tenant has not been released yet that I know of. And we expect a lot of development in and around the airport as well in Bern Township. I can speak today to the things that are happening on our property and a little bit to the things that are happening on the outskirts, but definitely a lot of future growth in this immediate area that's pictured. So the airport facility, our main runway is 6,350 feet long and 150 feet wide. And the secondary runway is 5,151 feet and 150 feet wide. Just to compare that to bigger airports so that you understand, like a Philly or a Pittsburgh, they're usually about 200 feet wide and they can get up to between 7,000 to 10,000 feet long. So we're right on the edge there. And obviously, like a smaller airport than us, let's say like a Chester County, they're usually like 3,000 to 5,000 feet. So we're right in the middle, and we do have a lot of good assets for Berks County and growth. Our runways are asphalt. Bigger, much larger aircraft can land on concrete. So when you go to like a Pittsburgh, they have all of their runways made out of concrete. Ours are asphalt. That doesn't mean we can't take bigger airplanes. We do have some World War II infrastructure underneath the asphalt, which is concrete, and that allows us to accept. You've probably seen the President's 757 come in, as well as 737s, and we've even had C-5s from the military and C-17s from the military come into Reading. So we can take very heavy aircraft. However, our runways are asphalt and they are grooved, which means that the water, there's actually channels built into the runway and the water's whipped away to the outside of the runways. And that helps in the wintertime to make sure we can prevent freezing water on top of the asphalt surface. It gets whipped away a little faster. And the HIRL there on the left, that's high intensity runway lighting. So that means that we have a higher end runway lighting system so that when aircraft are coming in, they can see us better. The airport is FAA certified. So what that, it's part 139. That's what that is there. And what that means is that the airport has a different set of regulations and a higher end of expectations. So we get an annual inspection from FAA, which we just completed actually last month. And they go through and make sure that we meet all of the requirements that would be needed to accept commercial air service. So as most of you know, and we'll talk about in a minute in history, is the airport did lose commercial service. And instead of letting that certificate drop, we've made sure to keep our good infrastructure in place and kept up with it over the years. It might have cost us a little bit more money, but I think in the end, it puts us in a better position for future growth and development and both sides, both commercial aviation and private aviation. So that means that all of our signage is in place and we have wildlife management programs, we have snow removal programs, we have firefighting and security as well. So you can think of the airport almost as its own little town or city. We have all of the major systems that a big airport has. We have a lot of the programs that a city municipality would have as well. We're a class four airport. That's just a designation for the size and what we can take. Our airport has commercial service through Boscov's Travel, our commercial operator, I should say. We don't have scheduled service. We have a commercial operator, which is Southwest Airlines, that does come in for the charters on a seasonal basis. So that elevates us to what they call a class four. And that allows us to have some even better access to grant monies for equipment. And that goes to that the next one, which is ARF. So that's Airport Rescue and Firefighting. And we're Index A. That's the level of service that we can provide, which we'll see later. We do have ILS and GPS approaches to the runways, which is really about accessibility. So it's really important for the airport to be accessible at all times in all inclement weather so that if a jet or a operator needs to get in here again, like Quest, that the airport's always accessible, even if there's like really nasty weather, both snow and storms. The EMAS, or Engineered Material Arresting System, that was on the news probably in 2021. We actually had a jet go into the EMAS bed, and that is on the east side of the airport between the main runway and the river. And that's a arresting system to stop the aircraft before it goes down the bank. So we do have that system. It is pretty unique to airports to have it, and it was paid for through the federal government as a safety precaution. And that's mostly because we're a certified airport. Otherwise, we would have been in charge of that bill ourselves. That system cost about $6 million to put in, and it just obviously has escalated since then. We do have an FAA air traffic control tower. So for our size airport, that's a great thing to have. And we've been able to maintain a great relationship with the FAA. And there is some potential for some upgrades in the future. The full terminal, the full service FBO we'll talk about, and our restaurant, Clingers at the Airport. That is a private entity that rents from us. However, we're partners with them to grow their business and grow our business. So So I'm sure many of you have come to Clingers at the airport. I think they're doing a fantastic job. They just did some recent renovations to make it more World War II themed. And we look forward to working with Mark Klinger in the future. Our main goals I have on this slide. So we want to make sure we grow business aviation growth, which again will help the community directly. We want to be financially stable. So that's important for us to make sure that any deals going forward with, on the airport lead us to success, you know, 30, 50, 80 years out. And that we have operation excellence and safety. So that's maintaining that Part 139 certificate, making sure that all of our operators and all of our ground staff are top notch. Alrighty, so I like, before we discuss the future, I like to see where we've been. So most people appreciate a little bit of historical background. So I could spend a lot of time on history, but I will do my best to give you a brief overview with some details here. So the airport was developed in 1938. You can see in the main photo here, the airport kind of laid with the Reading in the background. This photo is a little bit, you know, doctored for the time. They wanted to show off the airport, but for the most part, it's fairly accurate with the aerial imagery of what the airport looked like. You can see in the foreground, they have like a pipe laid in there to show, you know, some of the future development that they were doing. The airport at the time was only like about 3,000 feet long on the runway, so it was actually much smaller than it is now. And you can see how on the right-hand side of this picture, the only buildings that were here were the main main hangar we call the Old City Hangar, which is still there today. So when you drive past the airport, you'll see the rotating beacon at night shining on the top of it. And then there's a small building next to it, which was the restaurant. And that's currently a couple tenants in there, Olson Design and Contour Mortgage are in that building. And it's been heavily modified since then, but those were the two main buildings on the airport. You can actually see one of the things I like to point out is that the airport was about level with 183. So when you drive past the airport now, you'll notice that we're kind of on a plateau, which that plateau was sort of developed in World War II, which we'll talk about in the next slide. So in World War II, the airport expanded almost 10 times. Our runways got much bigger, and we were a base by the Army Air Corps was the reason for this base, and we had B-24 Liberators, which are in this picture here. So the top photo is actually, that's the original Reading Jet Center. Originally was a Reading Jet Center. If you drive up there today, that's what the buildings will say. We just bought that building back, and this is behind the FedEx. So if you drive up behind the FedEx, the ramp, we call that the West Ramp, this is actually a photo of that ramp from World War II with B-24s on it, getting ready for Europe at that point, because the Army Air Corps is actually responsible for building the airport to what it is today. And then the Army Air Corps took the B-24s, got them ready for service, and then flew them over to Europe. So the airport actually had 319 B-24s on the airport in 1944. December of 1944, I have some original documentation from the commander, the base commander here at Reading. There was actually over 400 aircraft. I think it was 420 about on the airport. Of the 420, 319 of them were B-24s. Now, just flipping back, I mean, this is a big airplane. So if you come to World War II weekend and you see the B-24, it's a four-engine bomber. I mean, you can see bottom right picture how small that gentleman at the top is. It's a big airplane. So I think 319 of those scattered around our property. You can actually see it in this photo. I'll give you a second to look at it, but there's all these little dots on it. All those dots and all those little groups of airplanes are all B-24s. So it's pretty amazing to see, you know, how much was here. So in this photo, again, there's a ton of things that were put in, and it's amazing to me how quickly. So bottom left, you can see the original hangar that we just talked about from 1938. In front of it, there's like this little strip. That's actually the original runway. And then they built the base around the original airport. Again, it's about 10 times bigger. So the Army Corps of Engineers comes in. They build the main ramp, the main maintenance facility hangar, kind of right in front of the old city hangar along 183. They build three runways, much bigger than the old ones. They have concrete ends to them so that the big B-24s can land on the concrete. They build ramps where the aircraft can park. They build three of those. They have a full ordnance center. There's a 300-bed hospital, which is over the original location would have been like Van Reed Road and Lizesbridge Road, which there's a industrial park there now. G&T Industries is kind of on the corner. So that's where the 300-bed hospital used to be. There was a full barracks, which in this picture is kind of top center. So that there was a ton of buildings back there. They built a sewer treatment plant. They put in all of the plumbing, the electrical, the water. They put in all of they put in a POW camp. So it's a prisoner of war camp. That would be bottom right of this picture. And those prisoners of war would have gone out to Anilani orchards and picked fruit and then came back at the end of the day. There was a full shooting range that they put in. They called a shooting buttress, where they'd actually taxi the aircraft out and test the 50 and 30 cal machine guns on the aircraft before that they were certified. The thing that surprises me the most about all of this is that they put all of that infrastructure in a year and a half. So think about how long a project takes now to get done, even a small building, and all the different approvals that need to be completed. And they did this whole base in a year and a half. So pretty crazy. All right, so after World War II, I don't have any intermediate slides, but we have, you know, we had a service here, and in about the beginning of the 60s, the Reading Air Show really started ramping up. So this is some of the initial pictures of the Reading Air Show. Again, a lot of history here at Reading, but after World War II, I'd say our biggest claim to fame was the Reading Air Show. So the Reading Air Show was a manufacturer show. You can see the top left picture. There was a big tent there, and bottom right picture, there's inside they had all their displays and manufacturers here to show off their wares. We were the biggest show in the United States. We were the second biggest show in the world. So the only show bigger than the Reading Air Show was Paris. So I have a magazine in our office. We were on the front cover of Flying, and there's a picture of the Reading Air Show, and it's like, hey, updates of Reading and Paris Air Show. So we were a prominent figurehead of the aviation industry back then. Everyone wanted to show off their airplane here. This is the first place. So the closest thing to this show in the U.S. today is Oshkosh. If you've ever heard of that, that's the biggest show right now in the U.S., and everyone wants to show off their planes there. That was Reading at one time. So the first question you're going to ask is, why don't we have that anymore? The biggest reason, or the only reason I can really tell you, is that the show slowly got almost too big for our county, and there wasn't enough hotels and wasn't enough parking, and slowly it began to move to other areas, and eventually the manufacturers kind of stopped showing up. So in about 1980, the show was at its tail end, and for 4 or 5 years, we didn't really have a show. So what they ended up doing was creating the Reading Aerofest, which started in 1985. I don't think it was called that right away, but by 1988, 89, they were using the Aerofest logo, which is the top left picture there. The show continued from 85 all the way to 1998. And that was the last show that we had the Blue Angels at. And that I get two questions at the airport on a daily basis, or at least the receptionist does when they call, right? When are you getting air service? And when are the Blue Angels coming back? So I'd like to say I would love the Blue Angels to come back, and I would love the Thunderbirds to come back, or one of the big jet teams. But the reality is that when you look at the airport, and we'll go back to this slide here, it's a lot different than it used to be. So first of all, the safety boxes for the airport are much bigger now than they used to be for air show activities. So anytime a jet team comes, they need a mile to a mile and a half square to have their jet operating in and around the airport safely over a crowd. So if you think about it, our runway, our main runway, is over a little over a mile long. So we need the box to be, I think it's 7,000 feet long. So it encompassed over the whole airport, plus vertically on this slide from north south, we'd have a lot of different houses in the box, the hospital. And essentially, no matter which way you shift the box, there's too many people that have to be evacuated from those areas. And it creates a huge cost issue, a huge safety issue. And it just becomes, unfortunately, not feasible for that big of a show at Reading. So we have some slides here talking about events in the future. We definitely want to continue growing air shows here at Reading. And they're just going to look different than they used to, right? We want to grow the festivals. We want to grow World War II weekend. We want to grow our Reading Aviation Festival so that people can still experience aviation and be excited by it. But unfortunately, it'll have to be in some way that doesn't involve Blue Angels or the Thunderbirds at this time. So after the show, around 2000, the terminal, main terminal was built, which is the top picture there. We had a booming service. Obviously, some or many of you may remember service here. In the 90s, we had commuters. We had U.S. Airways here in 2000. And we thought, okay, great. This is going to be a huge asset for the community. They put a lot of money into the terminal. It was about $8 million at the time. Unfortunately, after 9/11, things changed rapidly with regional service. And this doesn't just happen to Reading. So I don't want anyone to think that Reading is the only one that this happened to. But we built this brand new terminal and unfortunately lost service. So we had to adapt pretty quickly. Thankfully, the airport had some industrial parks, which I have at the bottom of the frame here. The one on the left is the Southwest Industrial Park, which is across from the hospital next to the 911 center. And then we have our North Industrial Park, which we talked about before. That's where the 300-bed hospital was and things like that. So there's two buildings up there. And fortunately, because we rented some of this land, the airport was able to sustain itself financially and not have to lean too much on the city or the county or anyone to like bail us out. So the county did help float the bond for that terminal. And unfortunately, we've been paying it off for a long time. And we will. This new operation that we have with the FBO will definitely help with that as well. One of the examples I like to tell people, this can happen, this terminal issue can happen to anyone. It actually just happened to Williamsport. They built a brand new terminal just like we did back then. And they had American, and I believe American just kind of dropped service about a year ago. Now, I have heard they're thinking about getting a small commuter back in there with a nine to 10 seat passenger aircraft that could still use the terminal. But again, it can happen to any airport of our size. Unfortunately, airlines can be very tricky in when and where they provide service, which we'll talk about a little bit too. So it kind of brings us up to today. I mean, we've continued since then changing our business strategy. Again, Christian alluded to needing a real estate license. I mean, yes, the airport makes money four main ways, right? We have land around in and around the airport that we lease. So that's our one of our biggest economic drivers at the airport. We have fuel flowage. So we used to take a fuel flowage fee. It was about 10 cents a gallon. Now we're the only provider of fuel. So that bucket of sales has gone up dramatically for the airport authority now. The third thing is landing fees. So anytime a turbine aircraft lands at Reading, we take a fee for them to land here. And then fourth, what unique to Reading, I mentioned it earlier, when we were a World War II base, they put a sewer treatment plant in. So we've upgraded that over the years, and we are the sewer authority for the immediate Reading airport area, as well as the hospital and parts of Burn Township. So that's a revenue generator for us as well. A lot of that money goes back into the plant itself, but it's still one of our revenue generators. You can see here on the aerial to the left, the airport kind of from the southeast, looking northwest, and our main runway there in the middle. And this is kind of how the pilots would see it as they're flying in. But you can still see, like, back in 1938, there was like no buildings out there. And now the community sort of built up around us, which kind of hurt, you know, it's good and bad. So unfortunately, that landlocks us a little bit for ever expanding runways. It is possible. However, because the, you know, 222 is on the other side of our main runway and the river's on this side, it's very difficult for us to expand that main runway. So what we've tried to do is, again, attract operators that have the right size aircraft for us. Again, 737 is the ideal design aircraft for this airport, and we'll continue again to look at that. All right, just need to pause for 1 second. I apologize.
This slide is very helpful. There's a lot of information here, Zach.
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, so there is a lot of information on this slide, and I just want, I'm not going to go over all this, but I want to, there's so much going on at the airport, and the airside operations here are our center point. So that's why that's in the middle. We start there every day to go over runways and taxiways and make sure that everything at the airport is ready for an aircraft to come in, but in and around that. So we start there, we go out, our team takes care of the pavement, the grass, the lights, the security, they take care of the airport rescue and firefighting equipment, first aid, medical, and all the repairs on the buildings. As we go around, again, we have commercial and landside operations that the airport takes care of on the industrial parks and works with those facilities and the township. We have our wastewater treatment plant, which we talked about. Now at the bottom, we have our fixed base operator, which is a whole nother facet to our business. And we've hired another 14 employees. So we have an FBO manager, a line service supervisor, the line service staff, the customer service staff that we all hired. So we went from, in the previous slide, you can see the top right picture, that's our main staff, which there were only eight of them. Sorry, there's seven maintenance guys and one mechanic. And we have myself, our my director of operations, and our director of administration, and a secretary. So that was the whole staff. And then we bought the FBO, and now we have about 25. So real quick, that's our snow equipment in the right center. And, you know, we do have a lot of equipment that we take care of the airport for snow ops. So I like just to point that out. Some people like to see that kind of stuff. And big plows, those plows have 22-foot blades on them, and then big snow throwers. And we can throw the snow like 100 feet or 150 feet off the runway, make sure that
I didn't go to the hospital. My sister wasn't out of surgery.
Oh, okay.
I know it's new to you.
Oh, I think we lost our presenter here. Let me let him know he's got to come back in.
I can print out what I have, but it's the narrative. I was working on the action plan.
I mean, it's up to you if you want me to start reading. If you have stuff that you want me to start reading.
Whoever's talking. Yes,
Jessica, could you do us a favor and mute your microphone?
Hi, Dave. This is Pam Mennett from the county. So I am a member of the airport authority by virtue of my position as director of community and economic development. And as you can hear, I mean, Zach is incredibly articulate about not only the past of the airport, but about where we're heading in the future. And being able to acquire the fixed-based operations there is really going to help allow us to control the destiny of the development, future development of the airport. So it's something that we're incredibly excited about. Just wanted to share that with you from a community economic development perspective. And also in our Imagine Berks Economic Development Strategic Action Plan, we have identified the airport as an incredible economic development asset and one in which we need to continue to lift up and start to pay some active attention to. And I think that what you're hearing from Zach is that we're exactly in that position to be able to do that as a county and as an airport authority.
Thank you, Pam. I'm trying to connect with Zach here. I do have his PowerPoint that I can try to pull up again. I don't know, Pam, if you could reach out to him, would that might help. And let me see if I can get to where we were. So I think this is where Zach was.
I think you're right, Dave. I think this is where we left off.
Zach is trying to rejoin right now.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Pam. Appreciate it.
We need all the help we can get.
Why don't you go to the next slide, Dave, and see if...
I think you just have to let him in, Dave.
Yep.
Thanks, Zach. No worries at all.
Okay.
You're a friendly group here, so.
Yes, we're all excited about this. So, and I will stop sharing my screen.
Really apologize for that. I think I had a momentary internet failure there.
Given the weather we've been having lately, it's not surprising.
Yeah, so it's interesting that that happened, but yeah, we have actually been fighting that the last 2 weeks since that last snowstorm, so there's a lot of different things going on, and I apologize. Let me just go here. So I think it was on this slide, so sorry about that. Pick up where I left off. So just again, we have... many administrative tasks that were taken care of, you know, again, fixing the internet is one of the things.
We were responsible for that too, huh?
I think that's the point of this slide is like, hey, you know, there's a many different facets to an airport. When you go to what we call a category X airport, like a Philly, a Pittsburgh, somewhere like that, they have so many different departments. One of the jobs that I had out of school, I actually worked at Philly International for 2 years in operations and security. And I did a very small piece of what we do here. I mean, I did the security end, we had a thing called River Watch, where we had to actually shut down the river for tall ships. Sorry, shut down the runway for tall ships that came on the river. So again, it was just, hey, watching for the boats and communicating with the tower. Here, we do all of those things with the 8 to 10 people that we have on staff. Between me, my director of operations, and our 8 staff members, we take care of the whole airport from an operations standpoint. And then our director of administration, Michelle, does all of our HR and different accounting tasks. Now we have, again, that FBO team we talked about, and then our terminal operations. So just general events, and there's lots of things going on here for sure. Alrighty, so our Southwest Boskov's travel flights. So I think most people are probably aware of the Boskov's charter. So we have that charter coming in about 10 times a year now. So it could be a lot more, but we need people to call Boskov's and book a trip, right? So right now they're filling a 141 passenger Boeing 737, which is the bottom left there. And that jet, is again our main design category for this airplane. And that can pretty much go anywhere in the country from here, depending on how it's loaded. So we're definitely primed and ready for service with that nice terminal in the top left. Again, keeping that up to date. It is 20 years old now, so there's things that we need to update in the terminal, but we haven't been able to justify that financially yet. So we're going to keep doing what we can, but obviously we want to be smart about it. We want to grow the business aviation aspect of it, and then that way in the future we can make updates to this terminal and keep it current. So you can see what the current operations look like inside. I mean, they still have the same motif from 2000, but I think they're shiny and we keep them nice and clean. Have the full security checkpoint with full brand new TSA equipment in there for the most part, and our main ticket counter as well, where we can still take baggage and do all of the main services. So I kind of wanted to talk about what we're doing with airlines. So obviously that is the first question we get here at the airport. When are you going to get commercial service back? And again, the Blue Angel answer, we would love to have commercial service. I think it would really elevate what we do here and have that community impact. And that's the biggest reason is community impact.
You don't get
and when any. You look at service for a regional airport of our size, probably won't make any money having the airline here. Very minimal, if not, most likely you're going to be in the red. Does that matter to us? No. We still want to have service so that we can help our community grow, have the service available there for people to leave Berks County and come into it as the gateway. I can tell you that as an example, I met with the director of La Trobe, Arnold Palmer Airport, and he has Spirit there. We went over a lot of things with how they got Spirit, but in the end, I said, hey, you know, is the airline operation in the black for the airport? And the answer is very plainly no. They put about $1 million a year into the airport to keep the service there. So the county actually gives them $1 million to employ all of the employees just to keep Spirit there. So all Spirit does is flies in and out of the airport, and they bring the airplane, fill it, and leave. All of the other employees are all employed by the airport. So it can be a difficult thing. Every time we talk to an airline, the question is, what are you going to give us? So some of the recent conversations we've had, we've said yes to a lot of these things, actually. Like, hey, can you provide advertising? Can you provide the facility without charging us any fees? Will you upgrade your equipment? We've answered yes to all of those things, but we've still not been able to attract an airline that can work out of here. I think the main hurdle that's keeping them from coming in is, can you prove to us that you have the market in the county? I think most of us in this meeting are going to say, yeah, we have the market. We know we can do it, right? But proving that to them can be difficult, and we've kind of struggled with that some. So any data, if anyone has any data, I'll solicit the group. If anyone has any data that they can help us get to prove to an airline that we have the market, we'd be welcome to it. The argument that I always have to an airline is, hey, you know, if we pick the right one, Reading has a lot of market around us that we can pull right from other counties and, you know, other airports if we picked the right airline. And we've been trying to get in front of those airlines to have that conversation, and we'll keep doing that. I think some of the things right now we're focusing on the charter is, again, growing the Boscov charter, maybe even providing other charter opportunities out of Reading that might go to other locations. So those are things that we're actively working on, and we continue to be open to those changes. All right, so events at Reading, lots of things going on. I can tell you, we strive to have top quality events here. Obviously the main one, World War II weekend, that's put on by the Mid-Atlantic Air Museum. I'd like to stress there that, you know, the airport does facilitate that event, and we love having that event. It is put on by the Mid-Atlantic Air Museum, though, so I want to make sure to not create any confusion. We do get a lot of phone calls at the office, obviously asking us about questions for the event, but most of them get directed to the Mid-Atlantic Air Museum because it is their show. But the airport does facilitate the event by letting them have it on that side of the airport, cordoning off, you know, doing the coordination from FAA and the TSA as well for security. And the museum, it is a great event if you haven't come to it, but definitely make your way out. So we'll continue to do that. We want to have the Aviation Festival as well, which is the top right picture. So that event, this is an aerial from last year. It was pretty windy and a little chilly. So a little bit, you don't see too many people in that picture, but that was a little bit early on. We had some nice airplanes there, though. We had a C-130 and some corporate jets, and we're going to continue. We had a lot of commitments, but unfortunately, the Middle East started to call for C-17s and some of the military operators that we had asked to come. So they all kind of declined last minute, which was unfortunate. But we're going to continue this year to ask for those assets and hopefully provide airplane rides again this year. We did have that all lined up. Unfortunately, last year, it was very windy. We had a great turnout, though, in the terminal itself. We had over 40 exhibitors, about 1,500 guests, we estimate that day. You can see the parking lot's pretty full out there and starting to fill up on the outside in this early picture. We have plenty of VIP visits to Reading. I'm expecting that could ramp up again. I mean, we had Pence, former President Trump, the current Vice President Kamala Harris, all come in over the last 5 years, I guess it's been. And every time that happens, obviously security changes. We kind of have to drop what we're doing for 2 or 3 days and really ramp up changing our operation around. I mean, you see in that bottom right picture, we had to, you know, they had to bring in buses and we had to get them a lift and all kinds of things. So lots of different hoops to jump through for sure. Bottom left, we have our car show. So big car show event at the Reading Airport every year in August and September timeframe with an operator that parks cars on the terminal ramp itself and has even cars in the terminal. And then top of the picture, we're very proud of this event. It's called Christmas in the Air. If you've not been to Christmas in the Air, I'd definitely encourage you to join us in December. The whole reason for that event is to provide free airplane rides to children. 2 years ago, we did 265 kids in one day as about a 4-hour time frame. So there's about 10 to 15 airplanes every year. And like I said, they did 265 kids, which was amazing. And those are free to those kids between the ages of 8 and 17. And this year, unfortunately, the event got fogged in. I guess Rudolph didn't hear us when we needed his help, but unfortunately, the event got fogged in. We did have all the inside activities and a great turnout. And I am trying to plan with the volunteer pilots to maybe do a makeup day in July, almost like a Christmas in July flying event. So stay tuned if you have any kids in mind that want to do a flight. I'm going to try to get that done in July. And then also continue doing that event in December. So we'll do that again this year in December. And we do plenty of fundraisers and all kinds of events in the terminal. I don't think I mentioned that, but we do have a terminal space for events. So if you think of anyone that we do business meetings and events in that space, it can hold about 75 to 100 comfortably for presentations. And then we've had up to 150 seated guests for certain types of events, like a retirement party that we had and so forth. We do a lot of aviation outreach. So most of the kids on the left-hand side here are all students from both Twin Valley and Wilson. And those students are, you know, 17, 18 years old, in high school, looking to figure out what they want to do with their careers. So we've had people that want to become pilots, engineers, aerospace interest. And it's been a great program. We've really enjoyed kind of showing the students about what we have here at the airport, take them through all of our things that we talked about earlier, like, hey, what do we do with landside operations versus airside? And how does that correlate to the aircraft actually flying? We usually get them in the cockpit. You can see that top left picture. That was Connor a couple of years ago, took a flight. We try to take them down to another airport or fly them around a little bit. This year, our students are from Twin Valley. Top middle picture is Faith, and bottom kind of center middle is Wyatt. And those students are from Twin Valley. They're actually currently working at our FBO, like learning about how to pump fuel. And that will probably transition to that type of operation, because I think they get a lot more hands-on experience and understanding of what goes into servicing the aircraft. And they also get to meet lots of people that way, which I think we all know networking is really important when it comes to understanding what you want to do with your career. On the right-hand side, that's Civil Air Patrol. So Civil Air Patrol is on the field. They have a very, I would say, a flourishing wing, they call it. And I think way over 30 kids at this point in their organization. I'm not even sure the number, but it's growing very rapidly. They do have they take adult memberships if anyone's interested. I know they need adult leaders and people. You're actually part of the Air Force when you join. And so they go out and do, you can see cleanup missions around the airport, but they also do flying with the students and even search and rescue missions. So if we had a search and rescue thing that needed to happen in the county, that would be one of the organizations they might call for either live large aircraft, like the 172, 182 that they're in front of, or even drone. They have like a drone team that can go out and do search and rescue as well. One of the success stories, top right, that gentleman's name is Taylor Heaster. He flies F-16s now, but he was local to Berks County, joined Civil Air Patrol, and now he flies F-16s for the Air Force, which is, I think, is a pretty amazing story coming from our local Berks County area. All right, what's in store for the future of Reading? I guess that's why we're here, right? This slide. So all of the blue, as you can see the airport in the diagram there, all the blue buildings represent future growth at the airport. So, and they're kind of blown up in and around the sides here. So starting from the left, you can see a big opportunity space that's kind of behind the 911 center and former IZOD building. And that is an airside opportunity to put in a cargo or some type of large maintenance and repair facility. So we've been talking with developers over the years about how to get that facility built, and it's really finding the right tenant. We do have opportunity to apply for grants, and we do have some in the works. So it is something that I think would be very opportunistic on the airside. Obviously, lots of growth around the airport, which we've kind of already talked about a little bit. and the airport's supportive of those growths. And I know Bern Township's working probably every day on a different project. And that's kind of how it's been in the township for the last year or so. Power is an issue. I know we are working with First Energy at this point. They've got all their approvals to come across our property on the left-hand side there from 183 up over 222. So they're going to be actually going underground underneath our runway protection zone, which is that trapezoidal shape on the left-hand side. So they'll go underground under the approach of the runway and then kind of come up on the other side. The west apron in the center bottom picture, we're looking to put in some new hangars there. So we are working with a developer. The more hangars we can put up at the airport, the more jets we could store here. And essentially, more jets means more businesses and Berks. So we really want to provide those opportunities, because if we can, then maybe, you know, someone can move their business here, which means more jobs. So, you know, it's just a big circle of life as far as the economy and growth. So just the more we can provide, I think will be better for the township and the county itself. Same with that bottom right center picture. I mean, it's just more hangar development, and how can we get more airplanes based here? So that goes into, you know, this is how we're meeting those goals that we set for ourselves. We want to concentrate on aviation growth. So that's both the big business aircraft in the top right. We want to get those based here, that's basically the business owners or the companies or the institutions that are hopefully going to move here to Berks. The center right picture is small general aviation, which is really important for building up business aviation. If we don't concentrate or at least do that aviation outreach piece for building up small GA, we can't keep growing the pilot community and the maintenance technicians that we need to fulfill the industry. And I think the better we do there, we also help all the colleges in the area as well, because some of the colleges locally are starting to think about those programs. I know like EMU in Lancaster and some of the outer counties have schools that already specialize. So I think if we can do that here in Reading, we really have a lot of STEM related fields that we can generate right out of our community. And that bottom right picture sort of represents the future of aviation. So we always want to be cognizant of where the aviation industry is going. That is in a fully electric airplane in the bottom right. If you saw it on the news, it's the same one that visited Reading this past year. That company is called Beta Technologies. They're trying to figure out how to create an electric aircraft that will transport medical specimens. So if you remember from our presentation earlier, we have quests here. I mean, it's all related, and how we can, again, grow that industry together. It's a huge business, and I think if they can figure out how to get that electric propulsion to work. Right now, it does work forward operation. You can see there's a propeller like in the back. They're trying to get that aircraft to actually be able to vertically take off and land on like the top of hospitals, so they'd be able to transport right to a hospital directly from the airport. Obviously, forward flight is more efficient, so that's why they want it to be able to fly forward, but then it would be vertical takeoff and landing onto the aircraft itself, onto the hospital itself. Some of the current projects that we have at the airport, so just showing you here, we've got a new tower potentially in the future, airfield lighting, a new parking lot at the terminal, and we have our new apparatus. So we upgraded the apparatus to try to get more service here. So that's something that I was working on with our operations team. So we actually got that truck on the right-hand side. It's a 3,300-gallon truck. Our current truck on the left is only 500 gallons. So that truck on the right, we acquired from the Air Force. We actually got it for free. We paid $1,300 to get it here, ship it here, but the acquisition fee was free. So it's something we're kind of excited about. Our fixed-based operator that we just acquired. So top left picture is our main facility. Sorry, it's kind of correlated here with the map. Bottom right-hand side of the map, right next to the terminal, is our main facility that we chose because of its location. You can see some jets there in that photo. And we partnered with AvFuel, which is our main fuel provider, and they provided some trucks. We have three new trucks from them, as well as three inherited trucks that we use. So we have six fuel trucks total on the field. And our goal is this year, about 1 million gallons. The other facility pictures that you see there are the hangars that we acquired. We acquired 9 different buildings with the sale and acquisition of those two companies. So over the last 2 months, it's about 2 months now, we're merging those three companies together, the two old facilities with the Reading Airport. And I think in overall, the operation has been going well. We started selling fuel on day one. Anyone that started a new business knows usually you have a little bit of time to kind of at least go over with your staff. We had to immediately day one to come in and sell fuel. So we tried to work with them as much as we could before day one, and then came into the facility. Everyone checked in with us and we started selling right away. So it's been pretty interesting journey so far. Obviously, any new business is going to have some teething problems, but I think that overall we're doing a great job. Our team is pretty fantastic. You see our team there at the FBO. So Ken Shadursky is in that top left picture on the right hand side. He's our FBO manager, and our line supervisor's in that picture as well, Gordy Clark, and then our line service staff, and we do have customer service staff as well that aren't pictured. But we've been doing some updates to the lobby. You can see bottom right picture is the original lobby, and then we just recently got new carpet and new paint. So we're going to continue to do that and make the facility nice. We want to make sure when people come in, they have a great first impression of our community. Some of our customers at the airport, lots of main through line on this slide is that they're all very different, right? We've got very small to very large in that bottom picture. We've got the 737. We've got utility vehicles in the middle, or helicopters, and then our main business jets. So overall, really important to be the gateway. This is the gateway. That's what this picture's here for, right? So this is the first thing a pilot sees, or maybe a corporation or a CEO or someone that comes into the county. We want to make that good impression, the facility look nice. We want them to come in to the FBO and be impressed. I think when they get off the plane, they look over, they can see the pagoda right from our FBO now. And just tying all of that community in is really important, and making sure that we continue to grow so the community does as well. So if we can be the best that we can be, we'll reach our goal of being the top regional airport in Pennsylvania. And I think that'll, again, it'll in turn benefit everyone here in the county of Berks. So I really appreciate, that's my last slide. I really appreciate everyone bearing with me through that little hiccup we had, but I'll take any questions that anyone might have.
Well, let me get started here. You did say that there's an interest in bringing commercial flights back to Berks County. What can the community do to help you with that?
I think the community directly, I would say a lot of times we get the question is like, hey, when are you going to bring back service? I used to do this or that. And sometimes I'll ask them like, oh, how often did you use the service? Like if they remember doing it.
Right.
Or how often do you travel now? Right. Like how often do you go see somebody through the airline? And they might say like, hey, I fly once a year. Well, unfortunately, that's probably not enough. What we need to know is, you know, how many businesses maybe the business community can help us more, because it's like, how many times do you send someone to go on an airline ride to go visit someone? Now that's reduced from COVID, but I know it's come back. The industry's returned to its former glory as far as numbers are concerned. So we did put out a survey with GRCA, but if anyone knows of a business that does a ton of flying, I mean, and uses commercial operators, any of that data that we can share with the airline, I think would be helpful.
Okay, that's good. Part of what we were able to do with the passenger train stuff was to show that there was really a need for the service, and it would be very significant in terms of the ridership. So helping you prove the ridership is going to be important. You mentioned that Boskovs uses it for their travel. Where do they send their planes to? Where do they take the people? Do you have any idea?
Oh yes, I'm sorry. Boskovs charter goes direct from Reading Regional Airport to Orlando International. So it's a direct flight. And they, if you call Boskovs, you could book, a lot of people know them for Disney, but you can book Disney, you can book Universal, you can go on a cruise, you can just go to the beach, you can go visit grandma, whatever it is. You can take that flight, you're there for a week, you leave on Sunday morning and you come back Saturday afternoon of the same week. So you're gone for about a week and it's a direct flight and it's basically private, almost like a private service. You're on the plane and, you know, once you start the process through security, you get through in like 15 minutes and you're on the plane in probably 30. So
is that something that could grow and expand? Maybe
it definitely can.
Maybe with other companies.
Yeah, I think they saw a decline. Was it beginning of last year, maybe 2022, they saw a decline. I think that might be for a couple of reasons. One, just recovering from COVID, and two, the rise in price of Disney World. I mean, if anyone's priced the trip there, it's very expensive.
Yeah. So maybe finding other places to go.
Yeah, maybe some other places to go within Florida, you know, if it is. But utilizing that service, people sometimes are still not aware that that's available. So they need to call Boskovs and really like at least price that trip out first.
Right, and maybe get some other partners doing the same sort of thing. The company, Jim, do you want to say anything?
Yeah, I say that we've taken that charter any number of times and it's incredible. You're in the park by 11 o'clock in the morning. You get a full day in the park. And then on your last day, you board the plane around 5 o'clock at night. So you've got time in the park and it's just so nice to be able to come right into Reading, not have to hassle with parking, and you're home in 15 minutes from the flight. It's been very well received both here and in Wilkes-Barre and in Lancaster. And it is something we're looking to expand. But you're right, there was a drop really as a result of COVID, and we're seeing that pick back up now.
Zach,
I want to thank you for making it so easy for us to do and for advertising for us as well. So thank you.
We're trying our best.
You had mentioned about the relationship with the schools and the students in the schools. How do you do that? What school districts you're working with? Who do you work with at the schools? Have you talked to the CTCs, for instance?
Yes, so Twin Valley and Wilson. Wilson was the first one, and they both have very strong internship programs within their schools. So we work within that structure. I mean, that I need that for sure. I need that mentor on that side of the school district to be kind of guiding the students to us. We can't take everyone because we just don't have enough time, unfortunately, we don't have enough people to facilitate that many students. But I interview students throughout the process, and we pick the ones that we feel that are the most interested in aviation and growing their careers with an aviation mindset.
So is that something we could help with in terms of nudging school districts or the...
I would think the biggest thing you can help with nudging school districts is making sure that they're aware of and push students towards our career fair in October. So that aviation festival is a career fair. And when I said exhibitors, that's what I meant. It's all schools and companies that are aviation based. And we really want to get students to that event. Sure.
Has the... impact that Berks County's had as sort of a center for logistics, the warehousing and all that sort of stuff had an impact on the airport? Is there a connection there?
Yes. I mean, I think there is. I mean, directly, it would be hard for me to say, like FedEx isn't directly flying in and out of the airport. Obviously, they're based right next to us now, but you know, we always see, it's hard for us to judge that, right? Because people come in, they fly their private jet in, their company jet to visit those places. So it's really important. Again, people see that private aviation sometimes and say, hey, that doesn't help me because that's some guy on his jet. It's like, well, no, that person picks Berks County because of the fact that they can move their business there. And then that helps all of the people that are employed by that business. So it's just, you just need to think of it that way instead of like, hey, that's just an expensive jet I can't afford.
A rich guy flying a plane, right. The reports that you mentioned, are they available to the public that people could take a look at them?
Reports for?
You talked about early on about the reports that you did for the, where
oh, the like the business plan and those. Those are public knowledge. Now, like any municipality, we're going to ask them to submit a right to know request, but yeah, we could definitely do that.
Okay. We had a question about noise, and airports have noise connected to them. What do you do about the noise, and is that an issue? Has it been a challenge for you?
Yeah, so we do have a noise plan. They basically come in and they do a study and create noise contours for the runways. One of the things that we do to try to curtail that, now, anyone that's based here, we talk to them about where to do their run-ups and where to make their, when they're doing their run-up, that's when their engine's going to be the loudest on and about the airport. The biggest noise complaints I get are probably helicopters, which I can't, we can't say, no, you can't come here because we're a public use airport. So anybody's allowed to fly in here. What we can do is ask them to, you know, maybe limit which runway they're flying on as much, but sometimes that's weather dependent and we can't always correct it. I don't get too many noise complaints, really. A lot of times, the biggest calls that I get are things I can't, completely out of our control. Like, you know, hey, a helicopter's flying over my house in Fleetwood. And I'm like, well, you know, it's not even my airspace, so we can't do much about it. take the calls. We do record it and then have it available for the FAA.
And control what you could control. Yeah, there have been a lot of helicopters lately flying around here. And I live in the city up by Albright, and we've noticed a lot of them as well. So I'm not blaming you. Let me see here. Where the private planes that are flying, you know where they're going? Is it more regional, or is it really fairly far away, or what?
So we don't track every single one. Now we do know, we do have a new program that we installed at the airport to get data. So we know everyone that's flying in. We at least know the type of aircraft and, you know, we can track the size and, you know, how long they stayed. However, we don't know exactly where they're coming from all the time. They do use a calculation. That's part of the data that we can submit for our economic impact study, though. So if we know how long they've been here for and the size of jet, usually we can tell about how much impact that is on the community, depending on the size of the aircraft and their length of stay. Yeah.
We have a question about whether the city of Erie did a daily flight to Philadelphia. Not that we want to interfere with the trains going to New York, but is there a possibility of perhaps going to flights to New York or Newark?
Yeah, I mean, it would be the same. It would be kind of the same answer that I said before about like attracting the airline. The one company that we had that was going to fly commuters that came in to talk to us, they were going to have like an 8-passenger commuter aircraft. It's very similar to the one that goes in and out of Lancaster. If anyone's familiar with that, they go from Lancaster to Pittsburgh. So it's a small little 8-passenger airplane. They wanted us to guarantee them $1 million a year in revenue. So that means any revenue they don't produce, we basically are paying them to be here. That particular deal, that was before my time, I believe we turned down, obviously. And, you know, it's too much for that type of service because it's only 8 passengers and it's only a couple times a week. Other than that, like, I think you've probably seen like a lot of most regional airports don't facilitate the same size aircraft than they used to. A lot of airlines want that direct flight, right? So, for instance, like Spirit going out of Latrobe, they go direct to Florida or wherever, like Las Vegas, whatever it might be.
Okay. a couple questions about, you know, related sort of the noise impact. Is there any environmental assessments? You talked a little bit about that, but, you know, how frequently do you do that? What kinds of protections do you offer for that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so we take the noise complaints and we create a report, and then that is given to the FAA. And then depending on how many and the severity of the complaints, then it would generate a study. And then depending on how the study turns out, then, you know, the airport may or may not have to take action to the recommendations. We don't have the same type of noise complaints that a big airport would have, you know, where they end up having to put in sound deadening and air in local homes and things like that. It's just, we don't have the traffic that a big airport has, right? You know, just to compare our traffic. So we do about 120 operations a day on average at the airport. But our yearly ops probably equal a daily operation at like Philly, right?
Philly, so, yeah.
You know, so Philly probably does 30,000 operations a day potentially.
Yep. Is there any other environmental impact for fuel emissions or any of that kind of stuff that you take a look at?
Yeah, I mean, the whole industry is looking at that for sure. And we're going to continue to be, so we talked about like electric aircraft and different fuel sources. So there is sustainable aviation fuels that the industry is working towards. And we're going to continue to stay on top of that. As it becomes more available to us, it is something that we could carry so that we'd be more environmentally friendly for sure.
And related to that, Berks County is sort of the battery capital of the world. And there are at least a couple major companies here that are working on electric vehicles, how they can work with that. Have you connected any of the people that you're working with in the electric planes with any of the local companies that might be able to help?
Yeah, we have been in conversations with EnerSys. I know they're working on some systems for battery car charging stations, which in turn could help with the aviation charging stations in the future. I think the biggest thing is right now the industry does not have a sustainable electric aircraft that can really provide the service flight times needed. But when that does start to become more of a reality, I think we're in a good position to expand with it.
Yeah, cool. Well, we're getting close to the end here, and I've got, let me see if get any other questions from people. I do have one that I want to end with. I've got a question about how much did the county pay for the existing FBOs, and are the appraisals available to the public? Everybody wants to know what you're doing in public information.
Sure. We paid, I believe it's $13.8 million for the current facilities. The bond was 15.8, so that we'd have extra for capital improvements, which we'd have to spend within the next 2 years. The only reason we even did this was because we had to prove, we did our due diligence to make sure that we can take that debt and pay it off with the revenue from the facility itself. So the county did not give us any money directly to buy it. We took a bond, which the county did help us with that part of it because they do have a much better credit rating, obviously. So they helped co-sign the bond, if you will, for that operation. But those appraisals may be subject to public record, but they could do a right to know request, and I would definitely put it by our solicitor for sure.
If people wanted that information, they should send you a right to know request.
And no problem. Yep.
Okay. Well, we've reached our 1 o'clock time. I have one final question for you. Have you ever considered doing a balloon fest and using hot air balloons at the airport?
I've never had anybody approach us. I mean, that's kind of a neat idea. Yeah, I guess it depends on like what's the impacts on the airport and the community for sure. Now, I've never pursued it directly. We do it with the events that we have now. I can tell you our plate is very full, but I'll consider any proposal someone brings if it's going to be like a cool, fun event. you know, especially if it helps bring some economic impact for sure.
Jim, you want to say something?
David, it's Jim Boskov. As a user of the airport, can I make a comment?
Sure.
Okay, Zach, first of all, thank you. This has been a terrific presentation and you've done a terrific job. And I think that you let people know what tremendous potential that the Reading Airport has. It's wonderfully located. It's got two big runways with instrument landing capabilities, a control tower, wonderfully located close to New York, Philadelphia, Washington, where there are lots of corporate jets that need additional hangar space. And I think you guys are doing a great job. So and the other thing I would say is that in taking over the FBO, you've put out much more attractive fuel prices, which will attract additional pilots and aircraft.
Thank you, Jim.
Appreciate that.
Thank you. And with that, Zach, we will thank you for the presentation. It was a great show. You have to thank the commissioner for us as well. As I mentioned, we will be making a recording of this. I see some of our friends from BCTV here will take care of making sure it edited appropriately and used well. We'll put it on the Berks Alliance website. We'll send it to everybody. We have other community forums coming up next month. We're doing one on early childhood education. And we do our spotlight programs as well. So hope we'll see some of you or all of you at some other thing in the future. And with that, thank you all. And we're going to stop the recording.